This is wonderful.
Harper Audio presents You Look Different in Real Life by Jennifer Castle, performed by Samantha Kwong. Chapter 1. Sometimes I hit pause at a random moment when I'm on film and stare at my eyes and try to figure out why they chose me. With the others, it's obvious. Rory says those accidentally hilarious things, and Felix keeps bursting into song. Kira reads an advanced level social studies textbook aloud. Then there's Nate, with that whole Johnny Appleseed vibe. Maybe I was picked because my favorite answer to their questions was, grr, or because I wore pajamas to school 3 days in a row, or simply because they needed a girl with brown hair. It could have been all of these things, or none of them. So I search those eyes I once saw the world through, and remind myself they're the same ones I see it through now. But in all the searching, I've never found the spark that says, watch this one. I'm guessing Ian Reed didn't find it either, and this is why he dumped me. You're awesome, Justine, he said, as we sat in his vintage Jeep, not going inside to the party we were supposed to be going inside to. But I feel like we're better off as friends. Translated, I'm pretty sure that means the thought of kissing you or touching you at all really makes me want to hurl, and when you look at me with love, you resemble a chipmunk. My heart doubled over from the punch, hacked a bit, then fell to the floor of its little heart studio apartment. But on the outside, I just nodded and spun out words like, okay, and fine, and cool. That was before Christmas, and now it's March, and there isn't a single hour when I'm not thinking about the fact that for 7 weeks I had someone, and then I didn't, and how that works exactly. This hour, I'm pondering it while sitting on a low stone wall outside the town library. It's snowing again, falling in bite-sized chunks so fluffy they look fake. I got an overdue copy of The Graduate on DVD, tucked inside my parka, and I'll go in and return it, eventually. Well, yes, the stone is cold down there, very, in fact. But this is so peaceful, with my mother at the supermarket, and thus out of nagging range, and I love the way Main Street looks before the plows come through. The air feels eerie hushed, and above me, everything is colorless, a striking shade of utter blank. In the distance to the west, I can see our town's mountains. They're not normal mountains with peaks, they're ridge mountains, low and wide and gracefully deformed. You know they're beautiful, but have no idea why. On top of one is a stone tower visible from miles away, with windows that look like eyes, and if you stare at it long enough, it always seems to be staring back. I imagine that Ian is here, perched on the wall beside me, with his arm around my waist, his chin on my shoulder, and this time I don't care how we look, or that some idiot might yell, get a room! No, wait. We lie down on the lawn and make snow angels. I know that's the stuff of trite Hollywood movies, but maybe that's where I went wrong. Maybe that's what he wanted. When we got together, people called us just Ian. The sun looked different in the sky, like it recognized me. And with that thought, the hurt comes again. It's a familiar hurt, and literal too. It starts at my belly button and pushes into me, as if someone's trying to dig a tunnel straight through to my back, but damn it, there are all these organs in the way. Justine? The voice pops against the stillness of the air, sharp and high. Familiar, but not really. I turn toward the voice. There's a man and a woman standing 5 feet in front of me, wearing ankle-length puffy-down coats and matching fleece hats right out of the clearance pages of an outerwear catalog. He's in black, she's in silver. They're each holding a cup from the chain coffee place across the street. Then I realize who these people are, and the cramp goes supernova inside me. Is that you, Justine? The woman asks again. I don't see how I can deny it. Yeah, it's me. I force myself to say her name. Leslie? In that moment, as her eyes widen, her brows lift, her face expands in every direction. I think about how I've seen her over the past 5 years, in pictures, but she hasn't seen me, and that makes me feel a tiny bit powerful. Oh my god, she says, quickly passing her cup to the guy, her husband, Lance, and stepping forward. Her hands fly toward my cheeks, and I let them land, feeling the jolt of warmth transfer from her cup. Then they jump to my shoulders to bring me in for a hug. My stomach still hurts, and for an instant, ridiculously, I think maybe she'll notice. You're so grown up, she says, squeezing tight. Her breath used to smell like cigarettes, now it stinks of a cinnamon dolce latte. That's what happens, I say, and throw a look at Lance, who just winks. Lance is the kind of guy who can get away with a wink regardless of unfortunate outerwear. When Leslie releases me, I ask a question. What are you guys doing here? What do you think? Asks Lance. I need them to say it. I look at Leslie. Taking the cue, she says, we got the go-ahead for 5 at 16. 5 at 16, I echo. In December, after my birthday, I was expecting the phone call, but it didn't come. Then the holidays paraded by, and nothing. Winter dragged on. At the end of every day without hearing Lance or Leslie's voice, breathing got 0.5% easier for me. I didn't think it was going to happen, I say after a slow motion moment. It's all I can do not to ask, who's going to give you any more money after last time, and that other movie you made that just plain sucked? Neither did we, but it was meant to be, Justine, and it's happening. We're in town for a few days to talk to people at your school and line up somewhere to live for a few months. We were going to call you and your parents tomorrow, adds Lance. Running into you like this, it's just so perfect, continues Leslie. I saw your face from across the street and instantly knew it was you. Like I said, meant to be. I have a feeling this film is going to be kick-ass. For the record, Leslie is way too old to say things like kick-ass. You will be part of it, won't you? Adds Lance. At least he's actually asking. Have you talked to the others? I non-answer. Just Nate so far, because he called us last week, says Leslie. They're all on board over there. You are next on my list, because if we don't have you, well, that's a lot not to have. They're wrong and don't know it. When would you start? We'll begin production next month, she says. But we need paperwork signed in the next week or so, to keep things rolling. I know my line here should be, of course, I'll sign your paperwork. Why would I not? In some alternate reality, I might add, I can't wait for you to slice open my life for the world to examine and poke at with sharp instruments. I don't say that. We're all silent for a few long seconds. Finally, Lance says, we should let you go, Justine. We're due at the realtor's office up the street. We'll talk later, yes? I just nod. Leslie touches her cheek to mine and squeezes my shoulder. And I wonder if that's some new version of goodbye they're beta testing in Los Angeles. Lance pats me on the back, in the same way he's always patted me on the back. Then they're gone, gliding away from me like graceful, overdressed angels of doom. My mother steps through the kitchen door with 2 steaming cups of cocoa and a bowl of popcorn, as if we were in a scene from a feminine hygiene product commercial. In this commercial, I sit at the table and she puts my drink and snack in front of me, then eases into my sister Olivia's usual chair across from mine. You think I should do it, I say to her. It comes out sounding like an accusation, which it sort of is. I do, but the decision is yours. As she leans down to blow on her cocoa, I notice the streaks of gray hair now woven through her blonde highlights. When she came to pick me up at the library and I told her about seeing Lance and Leslie, her eyes, which have looked so tired lately, suddenly sparkled to life. I don't know what to say next, so I blurt out the first moronic thing that comes to mind. I always thought I'd be thin in time for this one. Instead of coming up with a, you're not fat, or you look great, my mom stares in her cocoa, then offers an encouraging smile. You could still lose a few pounds before they start shooting. She thinks she's being helpful. That's my mother, in a nutshell. I just shrug and make a mental note to Steve about it later. After a few moments, I say, Leslie said that if they don't have me, that's a lot not to have. Oh, I agree with that. So do the people who loved the first two films. I know that's hard for you to hear. A line from one of the reviews my mother keeps in a scrapbook ticker takes across my mind. The real breakout star of 5 at 6 is the sharp-tongued yet funny and sweet Justine, whose early rebellion gives you a sign of things to come. Things to come. Gah. The intrusion will be a problem, I say, grasping. I'm supposed to be getting my school act together, remember? It'll just be for a month or two. Why is it so important to you? I'm curious to hear what she'll actually admit. Mom thinks for a moment, her expression warm but a little pain, and I'm glad for the pain part. I guess I still believe in it, the original idea of it. From the very beginning, it seemed like such an honor. That sounds sincere, but I know there's more. After the last time, her custom birthday cake business got a nice bump from the exposure. Now she's branched out into cupcakes and what she calls food art, which mostly means bananas on sticks with candy faces, and she could use the free advertising. Then there's the thing she won't mention. It made us all kind of famous for a while. You'll feel better after the whole idea settles in, says Mom now. I can see she's hiding a flash of excitement behind the concern. I have to get started on a T-Rex with red frosting. I go upstairs to my room and open my laptop, unable to shake that dark shadow feeling. The original idea of it. My hands, which seem to be much more motivated than the rest of me, open a web browser and type the address I know so well but refuse to bookmark. Here it comes, loading into place. The website for the Fiveat movies. I used to go on here a lot, watching video clips of the films or interviews with Lance and Leslie. Every time I went back, I'd expect to see something new, like it might tell me secrets I didn't already know about myself. When I realized it never would, I stopped. But now, I'm here again, and it's like the site has been waiting for me all this time. That homepage with the familiar logos of the first two films, dangling them. You know you want to. 5 and 6. The word 6 is carefully designed to look like some kid's doodle, colored faux sloppy with red crayon. In the 5 and 11 logo, the word 11 is written in chunky block letters with alternating polka dots and stripes. Then there's a tagline. The award-winning documentary film series that captured hearts and minds everywhere. As corny and cringeworthy as ever. But I click on the 5 at 6 logo, which brings up a page of information about that movie, and start to read. 5 6-year-olds, all assigned to the same table in their kindergarten classroom in a college town in New York's Hudson Valley. For the record, that's bullshit. I remember us getting moved to that table together, right before the cameras came in. After they'd interviewed 100 kids in a converted janitor's closet, then 25, then 12, before finally finding 5 in one class who they liked best. 5 of us, with the right shapes to fit together and make some bigger picture. Who are they? What do they care about? What are their hopes and plans? And what are their families' hopes and plans for them? What can 5 kids and their families, their school and community, tell us about our times? Filmmakers Lance and Leslie Rogers create a brilliant portrait of these children and their world, and ultimately, our world, and begin what will become a most amazing journey for all of us. The most amazing journey thing always makes me want to laugh, or barf, or larf. Maybe Lance and Leslie think it's amazing. First, their humble credit card-funded documentary was the toast of the film festival circuit and hit theaters in several big cities. After it ended up on cable TV and won a bunch of little statues, they announced their idea, and the big funding to go with it, to do a follow-up documentary every 5 years until we were 21. They never asked us to commit for 3 more films, they just assumed we would. So far, they've assumed right. On the page titled, The Kids, there's a picture of each of us at 6 years old, paired with one from when we were 11. At 6, I have shoulder-length, straight light brown hair with a barrette to keep it off my face. I'm looking at something above the camera with an arched eyebrow, a slightly slanted expression of, are you freaking kidding me? The photo next to it shows me with a short pixie cut, my hair brown black then, my mouth open in the process of saying something, because in the second movie, I was always saying something. Of the 5 of us, I'm the one who'd visibly changed the most. People thought that at 11 I dyed my hair and wow, that is so rad and how did her parents feel? Truth is, it just got darker naturally, but I didn't correct them. I try to imagine what the new picture will be. My hair is once again shoulder length. Sometimes I use a single barrette to keep it off my face, so it's possible that I could just look like a larger version of my kindergarten self. Shudder. I've had 5 years since they shot 5 at 11 to get ready for this. After what happened that time around, I was sure the amazing journey had screeched to a halt, sparks flying, brakes burning. This is not a soap opera, folks. This is my life. And it is absolutely, positively as unamazing as you can get.